Welcome back. So today I am going to take the following problem: constraint equality constraint, linear equality constraint optimization problem. Minimize a of x, f of x, subject to ax is equal to b. Of course, x comes from the n dimensional vector. So this is what I call as the linear equality constraint programming problem, the LEP problem. And here the equality constraints, this is not the first constraint optimization problem that we are taking up. In fact, we have already the convex programming problem that we did earlier, that also was a constraint optimization problem in many cases, because this is minimize f of x, this is a convex set, s is a convex set, and f of x is a convex function. So the moment there is a set to which the function has to belong, to which x has to belong, then provided that this x is not Rn, it is a constraint programming problem only. But now here onwards, what I am going to do is I am going to give more specific representation for the set of constraints. So in this particular case, this is A is of the form, constraints are of the form Ax equal to B. Now I am going to assume that these constraints are consistent. So what I mean to say is there is some x bar such that Ax equal to B. So the set of feasible solutions is non-empty. Otherwise, there is nothing to optimize. Also, typically this is A will be m cross n matrix, B will be m cross 1 vector, and I will assume that m is less than n. In any case, rank of A is less than n, because if rank of A becomes equal to n, then what will happen, all the columns are linearly independent. If there is a solution to this system of equations, then that solution will be unique. If that solution becomes unique, it doesn't matter what the objective function is. Objective function, minimizing an objective function makes sense provided there are multiple solutions to the problem, which means that there should be some degree of freedom associated with the constraints which I have here. So the Ax equal to B should be in that sense underdetermined. So Ax equal to B in this sense should be usually will represent a underdetermined set of equations. For example, you could have minimize x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square subject to the constraint that x1 plus x2 plus x3 is equal to 3. So this problem has one so this problem is having this A matrix here is 1 1 1, rank of A is 1, and there are actually how many degrees of freedom are there? There are 2 degrees of freedom associated here. For example, I can write x is equal to 3 minus x2 minus x3. I can choose x2 and x3. I can choose arbitrarily. and if I choose them arbitrarily, x1 will only be x1 is going to be set according to what I choose for x2 and x3. So I have 2 degrees of freedom here, and then it makes sense to minimize this particular objective function, because there are degrees of freedom associated with it. So hence, further, I will assume that rank of A is m, the number of rows. This also is not a restrictive assumption. Suppose you have x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 equal to say 5. Now you have another equation, let's say 2x1 minus x2 plus of x3 minus of x4, let's say equal to minus of 6. Okay. Now let's say the third equation is just the summation of 1 and 2. So I have 3x1 plus 2x3 equal to minus 1. Okay. Now in this case, A matrix will become 3 cross 4 matrix, and rank of A is only 2. The first two rows are linear, first two rows of the A matrix are linearly independent. Third is just a combination of the first two. So therefore, rank of A is 2. Now, while optimization, whatever be by objective function, while optimization, if I drop the third constraint, will it alter in any way the solution? It will not alter in any way the solution, because the information contained here is just redundant. If I have a point which is feasible with respect to first constraint and second constraint, it automatically is feasible with respect to the third constraint. So once I choose the best point that minimizes f of x subject to constraint 1 and constraint 2, constraint 3 will automatically be satisfied. So I can drop this constraint. So this has some, especially when doing numerical computations, this has importance, because it is possible that due to numerical precision problems, if I don't take such care, this set of equations may become inconsistent. For example, if this one changes, minus one changes to, let's say, minus 0.49 and then minus 0.49. Then the moment I add these two and generate this, this is not generated and the equation becomes inconsistent. So in theory, I have no problem in dropping, but in numerical practice, actually, I have to also formulate my problem well so that such situations don't arise. Okay. So with this preamble now, our problem is minimize f of x subject to ax is equal to b, x comes from Rn, and A is a m cross n matrix, B is a m cross 1 vector, rank of A is m, and this is what we have. So A is full row rank, A transpose is therefore full column rank, which is all the columns are linearly independent there. Now, how do we go about solving this problem? Well, there are 2-3 ways we can go about solving this problem. Let me list 3 possible alternatives to solving this problem. I'll illustrate it by using this example problem. And I said that I can write x1 as, for example, 3 minus x1 minus 3 minus x2 minus x3. So first alternative is elimination of variables. In elimination of variables, what I will do is I will substitute this x1 here in the objective function and eliminate this constraint altogether. So then my problem can be written as minimize over x2 and x3, x2 square plus x3 square plus 3 minus x2 minus x3 whole square. So this is this method is basically the method of elimination of variables. What is the other possible approach? Other possible approach is a penalization kind of approach, where I will put penalty to violation of the constraint that is given. So I'll put, let's say, I'll put this penalty term. So this is called the penalty term function or the penalty term. If x1 plus x2 plus x3 is equal to 3, penalty is 0. Rho will be some large positive number. Rho by 2 is just for convenience, so that when I take differential, the 2 vanishes. Now, what happens? So if x1 plus x2 plus x3 becomes 2.9, then this term will become 0.01. If this term becomes 3.1, then also this term becomes 0.01. So the penalty is always positive because of the square part which I have put in here. That's why I cannot take 1 to the power 1 or cube or whatever, but I can take 2, 4, whatever. 2 is most convenient. Now, if rho is large, you could argue that that any violation will outweigh the objective function, and therefore, as rho tends to infinity, you will end up enforcing the constraints and then minimize the objective function among this. So this kind of approach, though not required for a linear constraint problem like this, is called penalty function approach. But for non-linear constraints and even for proofs, this kind of approach is definitely used. But this is called a penalty function approach. The third approach is to use a null space basis. And in fact, the first approach of penalty function can be thought of, the first approach of elimination of variables can be considered as a special case of this approach. So now here, what I do is, I say that let Z be the basis of null space of the Z be the basis of the null space of A. So what is the number of columns in Z? N minus M as per rank nullity theorem. The number of columns of A should be N minus M. Each column is of course an n-dimensional vector. So therefore of length, each of length N. So Z is Z1, Z2 to Zn minus M, and all these columns are linearly independent. So rank of Zn is n minus 1 m. Together A transpose, which is n into m, and Z, which is n into n minus m, constitute a basis of Rn. You can check this out. This is nothing but a restatement of the rank nullity theorem. They constitute the basis of Rn. You could also say that every vector p of the form Zy He belongs to null space of A. In other words, it's orthogonal to the rows of A, and AP will be 0 because A times of Z is also is a 0 matrix. Okay, so this is here a 0 vector, M cross M vector. Now let us say that X bar be a feasible solution of the original problem. In other words, a solution of one solution of AX equal to B of my LEP problem. Okay, so AX bar equal to B. Let X hat be another feasible solution of LEP problem. So AX hat is also equal to B. So now if I subtract these two equations, I get AX hat minus AX bar is equal to 0, which implies that Z my X bar minus X hat belongs to null space of matrix A. In other words, they can be written as Z times some Y hat, because all the vector because Z columns of Z are the basis vectors of the null space. So all vectors in the null space can be generated by linear combination of the columns of Z. In other words, and all of them have a representation as Z of Y. So therefore, X hat minus X bar is equal to Z will be some Z times of Y bar. So in other words, if I have one feasible solution, to the LEP problem, then let's say X bar, then I know all solutions. This is the set of all solutions. This is the set of all solutions of my problem LEP, given that AX bar is equal to B, Z is the null space basis, then the set of all solutions of the LEP problem is simply given by this particular way. So with this characterization, now what I mean to say is, knowing one solution and null space basis, actually I know everything about all, though there are infinitely many solutions to the LEP problem, I know all of them in the in a nice way using the null space basis. Now, null space basis is not unique. It can be found in many ways, but we are not right now concerning with different which way of representation of null space basis will be better. Now, with this, we can now say that necessary. Now we can write down the necessary condition for solution to LEP problem. Okay, so we are now in a position to write down the necessary condition for the LEP problem. So what we are I am saying now is, let X star be a local minimum of my LEP problem, then we must have AX star is equal to B. This is just feasibility of the solution. I don't need to expand on it, right? This just says that X star is a feasible solution. Second, Z transpose gradient of fx of star should be equal to 0, or equivalently, gradient of f of x of star plus A transpose of lambda is equal to lambda star is equal to 0. And third, Z transpose Hessian matrix of the objective function times Z. This is also called as projected Hessian, is positive semi-definite. These are the necessary conditions for the solution to any P problem. If they are met, again I am emphasizing again that if they are met, it doesn't mean that X star is an optimal. Every optimal will satisfy them. But if they are not satisfied, you can throw away that point as not being optimal. So usually we also give sufficiency conditions. And let me write down the sufficiency conditions. Let me write down the sufficiency conditions for LEP problem. There could be many set of sufficiency conditions. I am giving one of them. And remember that necessary conditions have to be a subset of sufficiency conditions. So AX star should be equal to B. Z transpose gradient of f of x star should be 0, or equivalently, and the third sufficiency requirement, we have tightened basically something here, which is that the projected Hessian matrix, is positive definite. All right. Now let's prove it. Okay. The proof proceeds very much on the line of the basically unconstrained minimization problem, the way we did it there. Proof is very, very similar. What I am going to do is, I am going to look at a small feasible movements around the local minimum x of star. So in other words, I am going to take epsilon step along a feasible direction P. And what is a feasible direction P? It always has to be equal to of the form Z into Y. Because as I told you earlier, if two points are feasible, then their difference always lies is a vector which is in the null space. So therefore, this feasible direction I have written here now as f of x star plus epsilon times of z of y. and this, if I expand using Taylor series, will become, so I am assuming first order differentiability and second order differentiability, and that, and in fact twice continuously, whenever I invoke the second order conditions, then it, I mean that the function is twice continuously differentiable whenever I that's the point. So I can expand it now as f of x of star plus gradient of f of x of star transpose epsilon step z of y plus epsilon square, this is half of p transpose Hessian of h x star plus epsilon p is the direction, and there will come a theta here where theta will be between 0 and 1 and times of p. Means what I am saying is you are actually looking at Taylor series expansion of this, and then you are substituting p equal to z of y. So this term will become half epsilon square by 2 y transpose z transpose hx transpose theta epsilon p times z of y. So this is the Taylor series expansion. Theta is between 0 and 1, and I don't know which value of theta I should use. That is the last term in the Taylor series always gives me a challenge. I don't know what exact value of theta I should be using here. Okay. Now the first thing is, first point is that this term or other way to say is this particular term, just taking the transpose of it, should be equal to 0. Okay, this is to say that what is this? This is the gradient vector. What are the rows? Each row of the Z transpose, that is, each one of them corresponds to the vector from the null space basis. So therefore, this is a projection of the gradient on the null space basis vectors. And so what we are saying is that this projected gradient on the null space basis should be 0. Projected gradient of the objective function on the null space should be 0. Or other way of saying it is that gradient vector is orthogonal to null space. That's the other way of saying it. Okay, why? The question is why. So assume that to the contrary, Z transpose this is not equal to 0. If such is the thing, if this is not equal to 0, if such is the thing, what you can do? You can then take a step in the you can choose y such that Z transpose, what is the dimension of this? This is n minus m into n, this is n into 1. So the y transpose has to be multiplied from this direction. So I can choose it in such a way that this is less than 0. That is, just you choose, for example, y is minus of z transpose of f of x. then it will become less than 0. And then take a positive step. Then take a positive step here. So then the first term will reduce the objective function value. And by the similar argument as I did in the unconstrained optimization case, for small, really small values of epsilon, the first term will dominate the quadratic term. So the sign of the summation of the second and the third term would be decided by the sign of this second term. And hence, if this term is less than 0, I can ascertain by keeping epsilon below an epsilon bar that the sum of second plus third term is also less than 0, in which case the objective function value will reduce below fx with a new feasible point, which contradicts the statement that x star, given statement that x star is optimal. Hence, projected gradient cannot be 0. The projected gradient on the null space basis has to be 0. So this is my statement number 1. Straight away, very similar logic to the unconstrained case. Now, once this has to become equal to 0, what happens? You can see I am exactly doing the same arguments that I was doing earlier with unconstrained case. The philosophy is exactly the same here. Now it becomes equal to y transpose z transpose h x star epsilon theta p, or I'll just write p here, times z transpose of y, where p is nothing but z times of y. So now that the second term has vanished, everything depends upon how this third term behaves. Now let there be some vector. Let z transpose hx star, to the contrary, assume that z transpose z is not semi-positive, semi-definite. Then it means there exists some vector y such that y transpose z transpose hx star times of z of y is less than 0. And remember, p equal to zy is the feasible direction. So what we are saying is that there is some feasible direction which has a negative curvature with respect to the objective function. Now, this thing is called the projected Hessian. This is a n cross n matrix. This is a n cross n matrix. This is n minus m into n, and this is n into n minus m. So by projecting it on the null space basis, we have reduced the Hessian, projected Hessian, to a dimension of n minus m into n minus m. And this, because we have to the contrary assumed that, we have assumed to the contrary that there is some vector or a direction p where it gives a negative curvature. So now what is the consequence of it? See, I have taken f to be twice continuously differentiable function. Since I have taken f to be twice continuously differentiable function, so by the argument of continuity, see, this is one function, z transpose hx this whole thing, Z transpose H of X times Z, Y transpose, so this is of course a matrix, but Y transpose of Y is and you fix Y for the time being, you fix vector Y here, then this is a continuous. So Y, where are we? Where am I fixing the Y? I am fixing the Y. Okay. So where am I fixing the Y? I am fixing the Y in such a way. So let me write it like this. Maybe better. I take a vector P which is coming from ZY, and I am choosing Y in such a way that this is less than zero. Because I told you that this is P, this is the feasible direction P of movement, and that's come from the null space basis. So if this matrix is not positive semi-definite, then it means I can have a feasible direction P such that this is less than zero. Now P is fixed. The P is fixed. This is a scalar. This is a 1x1 matrix. So this is a scalar. And in fact, it has terms of the type xi, xj, pi, pj, summation over I, summation whatever n minus m, summation over j. And since this each one of them here, this represents a continuous function, and these are constants, their summation is also a continuous function. So if that function is less than zero, at x star, then in any nearby vicinity also, in a small enough vicinity, it will always remain less than zero. If that happens, that means for every vicinity, however large you take, but doesn't matter, in that there is that small subset where it will always remain less than zero by continuity or argument of continuity argument, and hence epsilon square by 2 is always positive. So what happens? F of x star reduces, I mean this value is lower than this of value for some epsilon below epsilon bar. Exactly the similar arguments that I did in the unconstrained optimization case, but I am already given that x star is local optimum. So where did I go wrong in this, assuming that this matrix could be indefinite? This is where I went wrong. It is therefore I reach the contradiction. And it becomes compulsory that projected Hessian should be at least positive semi-definite. Further, if projected Hessian is positive definite, then what it will mean? It will mean that this term at x star is strictly greater than 0. If this term is strictly greater than 0, then in a small enough vicinity, there will be some epsilon below epsilon bar, such that where this term will always remain greater than 0. If this term becomes greater than 0, then it guarantees that for epsilon below than epsilon bar, objective function value on the left hand side is strictly greater than f of x of star. What does that mean? It means you have got a strict local minimum, which is nothing but your sufficiency condition. So therefore the sufficiency condition is a guarantee that anywhere in the vicinity the function will increase. Now only thing that is left to show is this alternate representation of this particular form. That projected gradient of is zero, or the gradient of the objective function is orthogonal to the null space or the null space basis, is equivalent to a statement that the gradient vector is in the range space of A transpose. So this is what we want to just make this final proof, and then we are done with this important derivation. So basically I told you that Z and A transpose, this form the basis of Rn, is it not? So if this forms a basis of Rn, then what can I say about that? I can say that this vector can be written as the gradient vector of f of x of star can be written as a linear combination some mu star plus some component of with z, which I will let us call it as alpha star. Okay, so I am assuming that, so that means this is a vector in Rn, this is a vector in Rn, so it can be written as a linear combination of these vectors and these vectors. So I am using a term mu star linear combination, and with z vector I am using a corresponding vector alpha star for the linear combination. Now multiply this by z transpose. Okay, because I know that, why do I multiply this by z transpose? Because I know that gradient projected on the null space has to be zero. So I write this as z transpose z times of alpha star. Okay, now what happens to the left hand side? This is zero. Because z is a null space basis, we already know that Az is zero. So therefore z transpose A transpose is also a zero matrix, plus z transpose z times of alpha star. So that means that z transpose z times alpha star is zero. But what is z transpose z? Z transpose z is actually a n minus m into n minus m positive definite matrix. You try this out, all right? If you are not sure about it, you try this out. It's a positive definite matrix, hence it is invertible. Hence, if it is invertible, then alpha star has to be identically equal to zero. So if alpha star becomes identically equal to zero, then what does this equation say? This equation then says that the gradient vector f of x of star is in the range space of A transpose. It can be written as the linear combination of the columns of the range transpose. In other words, if I take this to left hand side, then this can be written as A transpose plus minus of mu of star is equal to zero vector, and this minus mu of star I call it as a Lagrangian multiplier vector, which I will connect in the next class. This should be set to zero. So this is actually a special case of the Lagrangian multiplier theorem that I have written here. So what we mean to sort of say here is that let's say this is one constraint, then the normal to this is like this. Let's say there is another constraint like this, then the normal to it is something like this. So this objective function plus, let's say the objective function will be somewhere here, or if you look at it from the mu star perspective, then what it means to say is that the objective function will come out to be a linear combination on the range space of this. In a two-dimensional thing, it's a bit it's not very easy to illustrate it. But essentially, I mean to say is, see, if for every constraint, the A transpose, these linear constraints, the A transpose represents the normal to it. So these normals to this is the direction around which this A transpose X will increase. So those normals linear combination will lead you to the gradient vector. This is the other way of geometrically interpreting it. One way is, this is orthogonal to the null space basis of the A transpose. Another way is, this is in the range space of the normals of the linear equality constraints. Now we will take an example after this, and then we will generalize it to the case where the equality constraints could also be nonlinear functions. All right, so let's take an example. Minimize half of x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square subject to constraint x1 plus x2 plus x3 is equal to 3. So here the objective function contours or loci of objective function represent the spheres. The contours here are going to be spheres. That means if you take x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square is equal to r square, then it is a sphere of radius r, is it not? And x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to 3 represents a plane. So this represents a plane. So you can, analog of this would be to say that in a two-dimensional plane, analog of this would be minimize half of x1 square plus x2 square subject to constraint x1 plus x2 is equal to 2. So here the constraint represents a line 1 0 here, 0 1. 2 0 and 0 2 here, and then the point, if you connect these two points, what you get is a line, and the circles would correspond to the objective function would correspond here to circle. The objective function, if you consider circles of radius r, then the objective function value is r square by 2. So if you want to minimize this circle, the constraint that we have got is that unconstrained minimum is 0 0. Radius, you set the radius to 0 and you will get the unconstrained minimum, which is at the origin. But this is infeasible, right? Because your point should lie on x1 plus x2 is equal to 2. So therefore your point should lie on this. So one way of looking at it is, like, you start with a small circle, then increase its radius. So you start somewhere here, make a small circle here, then you don't like it, you don't like it means it's not touching, so increase its radius, then further increase its radius. At some point of time, At some point of time, it's going to touch, this circle is going to touch this straight line, is it not? And then this is actually your, this is where your X star is there, because if you increase the radius any further, what happens? The objective function value increases, and now you have got multiple points of interaction, multiple points of intersection also. So you have multiple feasible points here, but your objective function value has unnecessarily increased beyond what it was when it was actually touching this. So this touching point tends to be X star here. So this is the geometry of this problem. Now what we have taken here, is a sphere. So you can imagine concentric spheres of larger radius. You have to keep increasing them until they touch this particular plane. That's what that is what we are trying to solve here. So what we need to do, this is essentially a non-objective, this is exactly what we have been discussing, right? Minimize fx subject to the constraint that ax is equal to b. Here there is only one constraint, which is the A matrix is just 1, 1, 1. B is unity. And so what we will just do is, we will write a Lagrangian function as follows. What is our Lagrangian function? Half of x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square plus just one scalar lambda 1 plus x1 plus x2 plus x3 minus of 3. This is our Lagrangian function, and we look at its stationary point, and to get the stationary point, we have to look at the stationary point. We first take its gradient with, set its gradient with x1 to 0, which will give us x1 plus lambda to be equal to 0. Then you set its gradient with x2 to 0, which gives x2 plus lambda to be equal to 0. And you set x1, its gradient with respect to x3 to 0, and that gives you condition that x1 plus x3 plus lambda should be equal to 0. And so the optimal point should satisfy this particular condition, is it not? Then what we have, therefore, x1, this tells you that x1 square, x1 star is equal to x2 star should be equal to x3 star. And given that your constraint is that x1 plus x2 plus x3 should be equal to 3, so this means that this should be equal to 1, which means that lambda star should be equal to minus of 1, which means that lambda star is equal to minus of 1. So this is exactly what we were saying. The last condition, of course, as I told you, this should be equal to 0, is means that x1 plus x2 plus x3 minus 3 should be equal to 0, which is just a feasibility condition which any optimal point has to satisfy. So what we have essentially got is that gradient at this should be equal plus of A transpose lambda should be equal to 0. So this is what we wanted, and we got this with
our gradient at gradient of objective function is going to be so x1 star which is 1, x2 star which is 1, x3 star which is 1 plus the A transpose vector is again 1, 1, 1 into minus of 1 becomes equal to 0. So the necessary condition for optimality is satisfied. This is necessary condition is satisfied. And if you look at the projected Hessian x star h z star, actually what is the Hessian matrix here? It is 1, 1 and 1, because del square f with respect to delta x1 square is 1, del square f with respect to any other derivative is 0, and identity matrix is a trivial positive definite matrix. So any restriction z transpose hz will also be positive definite, in fact symmetric positive definite, if h is symmetric positive definite. So therefore, why is that? Because if you look at x transpose hz times of x, it is zx transpose and then h, and this is always greater than or equal to 0. So call this as vector y, call this as y transpose, and you get this as y transpose hy, which is always greater than or equal to 0 if h is positive definite. Now if, since the z is our null space basis, since the z is our null space basis, it is full rank. So the rank of, so it is full column rank, all the columns are linearly independent. So therefore, if x is not equal to 0, zx will also be not equal to 0, because otherwise it means that the columns of z are linearly dependent, but those are the basis vectors. So therefore, when x is not equal to 0, y is also not equal to 0. So y not equal to 0, if h is positive definite and y is not equal to 0, then y transpose hy will be greater than 0. So therefore, actually speaking, z transpose hz is the projected Hessian is positive definite, and hence the sufficiency conditions for second order what are the sufficiency conditions for minimum? First, stationary point of Lagrangian function. And second, the projected Hessian is positive definite. So that is also satisfied. So we can say that 1, 1, 1 is a strict local minimum of this problem. But
you can do something better. What is that better you can do? If you realize that this objective function, though I took this as an example or for application of the Lagrangian multiplier theorem, if you look at this, that this function is this is actually a convex programming problem, because this is a convex function and this is a convex set. So if you have found a local minimum, then you actually know that it is also a global minimum. So I hope you got some idea of how easy it is to apply this set of conditions. Thank you.